In this video, I'm gonna show you how you can pull your contact information from your ActiveCampaign into the Google Tag Manager data layer to customize, segment, and personalize your tracking and website. All or more, coming up. Hey there, and welcome back to another video of measureschool.com teaching you the data-driven way of digital marketing. My name is Julian, and today we want to talk about how we can pull data from our ActiveCampaign account into Google Tag Manager's data layer. Now, it's oftentimes the case in our tracking that the data actually lives in different places. There's Google Analytics, there's Facebook Analytics, and there's sometimes also your CRM system like ActiveCampaign, where you have the data and rich data really available that you could use in different tools, but it's just not there because the tools don't talk to each other. So for instance, in ActiveCampaign, we have rich profile information about the user that's actually visiting our website. Now, if we just had that information available in Google Tag Manager. So I've written a little bit of an AppScript that actually makes these two tools talk to each other so we can pull information from ActiveCampaign right into our Google Tag Manager data layer and use it from there for personalization, segmentation, and customization of our tracking and of our website. If you want to get a hold of the script, then check out the link down below. But if you want to learn how to install it and how to use it, then we got lots to cover. So let's dive in. All right, let's first take a look at what we are trying to accomplish here. So I've sent myself an email newsletter from ActiveCampaign, and when I click on this link, I go to our demo shop, and please notice up here we have our contact hash in the URL. This will then be connected to Google Tag Manager. It will pick that up and send that information over to AC via a tag. And that tag will then receive information which will be pushed into the data layer, as we can see here. And we can see what data layer information is then available to us. We have subscriber ID, we have the sign up date, the email address, the first name and the last name, how many times it bounced. So there's a lot of information available in this data layer push now, including custom fields that we might have set and even the actions that the user has taken, in which automation he is, which tags he has attached to his user profile. Really just mimicking what we can see inside of our contact record in ActiveCampaign. So this is great information that we can use with Google Tag Manager to customize our website for the user. So with the help of Google Tag Manager, we can pull out this information and customize or segment or personalize our appearance on our website. So for example, here we pulled data out of the data layer and filled out or pre-filled this form field with the email address that we have in the data layer available. So really great information that we can get from ActiveCampaign. How do we get it there? Well, let's go through the steps. First of all, we need to build an API proxy with the help of Google AppScript. So this is the AppScript that I have written in order to pull the information from the ActiveCampaign API. And we would need this proxy in order to not expose our API key on the client side. Luckily, AppScript is free and you can simply open up this script and then go to File, make a copy in order to make your copy on your Google account. Once it's on your Google Drive account, we need to do some configurations in order to get this working. First of all, we would need to replace the XXX here with our ActiveCampaign API URL. You can find that in your ActiveCampaign under the settings. You find here developer, and there's where you get your URL and your key. So first of all, let's go with the key, copy that over to our script. And then we have our URL and we copy that over to here as well. Once this is done, you can take a look at the code here. It really just takes up some information from the URL that we're going to send it to it and then sends it on to ActiveCampaign, gets a response back and forwards that on in JSON format back to our client. Now all you need to do is save this and then go over to publish here and deploy this as a web app. Now, you can leave these untouched. The only thing you need to change is the last step here, anyone, even, and anonymous. Click on that and then deploy. It will ask you for some permissions as you are deploying a web app here, and this web app will be accessible to the wider internet. So you need to confirm this with your Google account. It will connect to external services,
which in our case is the ActiveCampaign API, and we get our web app URL. So this is the URL you need to copy because we'll need it later again. Now, in order to make this all work, you would need to have something set up in your ActiveCampaign as well. And this is the links that go onto your website. So every time you send out an email, let's go over to our test campaign here, and you design a new campaign, all the links that point to your website actually need to be correctly tagged. So you see here we have a link that is pointing to our demo shop, and we need to attach a special tag in order for our script to work. And this is the subscriber hash. Now, if you don't have any kind of query parameters in the back of your URL, you would write a question mark and then write the ACID, which is the active campaign ID, equals, and then you'll put in a personalization tag that you might know from ActiveCampaign, which is surrounded by these percentage signs, and you'll write in all caps, subscriber underscore hash. You would need to do this for every link in your newsletter or in your designer of your email that goes out that actually points to your website in order for these people to be identified. This is how the information gets from ActiveCampaign to your website and is picked up by Google Tag Manager, at least the identification part. Now, what this will do, let's send out a test newsletter here. You'll get your newsletter in your inbox, and once you click on it, it will actually replace that subscriber hash with the actual subscriber hash of that user, which we would need to identify the user correctly with our API. Now that we have the information on the website, we would just need to pick it up and query the API for the right information and then push it back into the data layer. This is something we will do with Google Tag Manager. So I have Google Tag Manager installed on this demo shop here. And the first thing we need to do is to pick up whatever is in this ACID field. Luckily, we have the ability to do this with Google Tag Manager. In the variables, we can build a query parameter variable. So let's go here under variables, user defined variables, click on new, and as the type, we'll choose the URL variable. The component type will not be the full URL, but the query. And we can put in a special query, which in our case is the key that we see up here, and our key is ACID. So we'll type this in and give this all a name, save this, and let's try it out. Let's refresh here, go back to our demo shop, and then under variables, we should see our URL ACID is now filled with this particular subscriber hash. The next thing we want to do is to actually build a trigger every time there is a subscriber hash, because we don't want to fire our tag and do an API query if there is no hash available. So let's build a trigger in Google Tag Manager. This will be a simple trigger that is evaluated on the page view event. And we only want to fire this on some page views where our URL ACID is actually filled. That means in Google Tag Manager terms, it's not equal to undefined. Let's give this all a name on the page view. ACID is present. Let's save this. We can't really test this. We would need to attach this all to a tag. So let's build our tag that actually does the API query or really talks to the Google Apps Script here. And the Google Apps Script then makes the query and sends it back to our tag. We'll simply build a listener for our ActiveCampaign contact information. This will all be done via a custom HTML tag, and I have something prepared here that I'm also going to link up down below so you can copy this. And all you need to do is now replace the placeholders here. So this needs to be your AppScript URL. Just copy this and put this in here. And then replace this with the variable name of your subscriber hash. Now we have built the subscriber hash beforehand, so we'll just type two curly brackets and this will open up this little menu where you can choose your URL ACID. Now this will be automatically replaced once the user comes in. This looks all good. Now let's attach the trigger that we had built previously and save this all. Refresh our preview and debug mode. Go back to our page. We still have the ACID here in the URL. Let's refresh. And we see our listener has been deployed. It sends information to our AppScript. The AppScript information sends it on to the API. The API responds and pushes it back into the data layer with a special event called ACUser. So once we click on that and look into the data layer, we have all this information now available about our user. And this would be obviously different per user that clicks on that specific link in their email. They have a different subscriber hash and different information would be pulled. So this is how you can set up the contact information push into the data layer. By the way, if you are interested in the listener functionality, it's really just a AJAX call that we're doing to our AppScript. We are passing on our ActiveCampaign ID hash and feeding that back into the data layer. The only thing that we change in this data layer is that we use a special event key called ACUser. If you want, you can change that. But that's really it. In the end, what can you actually do with the data now that we have it in the data layer? Well, first of all, you can pull it out of the data layer via data layer variables. How would you do that? Let's pick a couple of here. We have first name, we have the email address. Yeah, let's take these and put them into our variables. Let's click on new user defined variables. This will be a data layer variable for the first name. And we'll just choose our data layer variable type. And then we need to have the key of the data layer itself. So in our case, that would be the first name key right here. And we'll just paste it in here. Let's save this. And we want to have another key, which is email key. So I'll just build a new data layer variable with our email key. And we have this as well. So once we refresh and refresh our page, we should have that information available in our variables now. Right here, email and first name are filled out. Now we can use that data to actually customize or segment our data. Let's take this newsletter widget as an example. Now, since the user is identified, you already know their email address. So you could pre-fill this form field in order for them to have it easier to sign up to the newsletter. How would you do that? I have a little bit something prepared here already. We have these on-site action items. And here's a little bit of JavaScript that will select the form field and then give it a special value. In our case, we want to fill this with our email value. We need to attach a trigger to this and we'll choose a new trigger that is actually a custom event because we need to have that data available at the right time, which is the ACUser event. So let's take our custom event trigger here, which we will fire on the ACUser event. Once that information is available, all custom events, that's fine. We'll just choose our custom ACUser. Let's save this and attach this to our tag as a trigger. We'll refresh and refresh our page. And as you can see, it changed it over to the actual email address that we have in the data layer, which is pulled from our ActiveCampaign information. A second thing I want to show you is changing text here. Personalizing the website. You could do this in many different forms. We'll just do this for now in the text form, which we have down here. Again, I'm just selecting the right element in the document object model and then assigning a new text to the node. In our case, we want to have our first name, but not just the first name. We have hi there, so it would be all right, so that should do it. Let's try this out. Refresh, and we have a unsupported reference. That's because I now have commented out our DLV email address, and it still has our variable in here, which is not allowed. Let's refresh and see if our script works. And now we see, hi, John. It has changed it depending on the user, again, that comes from ActiveCampaign. And you could also obviously use this for segmentation. So trigger a tag based on the user that is actually on the page itself. So for example, let's say I completely don't want to show this at all if a user is already identified as a newsletter subscriber, because why would he actually need to sign up again when he's already coming from a newsletter? Well, that's also something we can use for our tags. In our action items, I have a little JavaScript here. Get rid of this, that actually hides the element of our widget. Now all we need to do is actually simply use our trigger here and refresh our page, refresh our site, and now we see our widget has gone. Now you might have noticed that there's a little bit of a flash effect. So the page changes after the initial page load, and that is because the API needs to be contacted first and send information back in order for us to decide whether we want to show this or not. This is an obvious downside of this method. We need to wait till the API comes back with information in order for us to customize the website. There are workarounds with A/B testing tools that you might know of, but this is just the nature of getting the information first before doing an action on the website with JavaScript. The other concern I want to address is you may be thinking, well, this seems to be all personal identifiable information. How is it with our privacy laws? Well, yes, there is personal identifiable information in here. Therefore, I would recommend to not pull certain data points like the first name and the last name into tools like Google Analytics. But for our purposes and what the script does anyways, is it just exposes the information that the user has given us previously. It also exposes only the information of the user that is actually on the website. He can't read any other information. And it doesn't save that information in Google Tag Manager, because if I actually navigate on to the next page, we don't have the ActiveCampaign ID up here anymore, and our data layer won't be filled with our AC user information. Which brings us to the next question, which is obviously it only works when the user just came from the newsletter or from the link of the email that he clicked. That's true. You could take this data layer information and push it into something like local storage or a cookie in order to have it available later on for personalization purposes. But that's something we covered in other videos on how to persist data with Google Tag Manager in cookies, for example.
All right, so there you have it. This is how you can pull your contact information of the user who's visiting your actual website at the moment from your ActiveCampaign account into the Google Tag Manager data layer and use the data for segmentation, customization, and personalization of your tracking and your website. Now, the possibilities are really endless here, so I'd love to hear from you. How are you planning on using that data, and what is your use case really? Leave a comment down below. We can all learn from each other. And if you like this video, why not give us a thumbs up and also subscribe to our channel right over there, because we'll bring you new videos just like this one every week. Now, my name is Julian. Till next time.